Peter Neuber, Designer, Writer, Architekt, Curator, Director, Artist.
Okay, Finish Director.
Yeah, but maybe in the future. This is why the lecture is for.
Okay.
Peter Neuber, Designer, Writer, Artist, Designer, whatever. And very important, he is an Aktionista. What does it mean? This is a guy who is doing all the things together on one point. And like the title of the lecture is Now, he is doing it now. But Peter is also, and this is even for me more important, a very generous and great friend. He is a defender of art, and or a fighter for art, and with his very powerful voice, he's defending the artists, of course. If I would have to describe his attitude, I would quote a text he wrote on a t-shirt long ago, namely, don't compromise, you will pay the price. It's a perfect description of his character. Actually, the other day, someone asked me, how can you describe the character of Peter Neuber? And I said, character. Peter was almost 70 years ago born in 70 years ago in Tyrol, And like all these guys from Tyrol, like his friend Peter Neuber or Raymond Abraham, they really did come to Vienna in order to prove that the Viennese are the most stupid, stubborn, and worst guys you can imagine. This is what Peter did for 50 years. 25 years as a kind of actionista, and 25 years as the director of the museum, the Mack Museum. Before he was the director, he was famous, very famous, because he always put every year a poster on the wall of the hotspots of Vienna, and the posters were announcing the motto of the next year. And Peter Neuber was always on the poster and called Noeber, and the poster was "Design is Thinking," or "Buried Vision," or "Go Ahead, My Friends." So I did know him before I met him. And his famous, very famous input to the cultural scene in Vienna was the magazine, I would call it a political cultural magazine, Umriss. How can I translate it, Umriss? I would say the best translation is How to Kill Mediocrity. And this was a pain in the ass of all bureaucrats of Vienna. And every time you mentioned the name Peter Neuber, the bureaucrats got very, very pale, because his pamphlets, his statements, his action were really the hot spot of Vienna, trying to, like I said, to take a stand for art. And he is an architect as well. The design for the recent proposals, like the Mack Tower, Cat Tower, or the future of the Mac, was laid down first in, is very famous, and I don't know whether you know it, a very famous land art architectural project in Burgenland, the so-called Pit, and this is where he proved that the Viennese tradition in being concerned with subterranean articulated shapes are more important than upstairs, like in other countries. Peter Neumann, I'm very glad to have you here. I have to say, and I have to quote what I always say when I introduce him. No ever glad, so he is not slick. No ever rest, like the mountain. Peter Neumann forever. Give a welcome to Peter Neumann.
So, first of all, I have to speak in English, which we'll try what we can do. Thank you, Wolf, for your beautiful introduction. Now it's even more hard to say anything, to make a lecture here, and for your performance. I'm not so sure if everything you said, that I still can try. I'm not 70, as you mentioned, so I still can try to fulfill the ideas you have on me. Huh? Almost. So, but the thing which is in always and also in the present, which is the main interest, if I may say so, is the site, and especially the site of art or the site of artist, and also the time. I think I always tried to do things, and I could not understand in a different way, to react in the moment and to be, to have really the when I called, have this title, so I was not sure which title to select, but I think this is what always was driving me. This is this kind of curiosity. The curiosity, what is going on? It doesn't mean that you have any idea what's going on. I think this is always very complicated. And also, just a question, where is art coming? Where is the artist? How you figure out who is the artist of today? I don't think it's to go in a museum, and I know a little bit about the institution, like a museum. I'm not sure if you dare have any chance to figure that out. So this is not something to say against an institution. I mean, I have many things to say against many institutions, but it's still what just to trying to understand myself. I think it's the site. The site is something. What I mentioned. The side of art, I have an explicit interest in always, in the manifestation of the here and the now. In art that is capable in creating context, externing an influence on social consciousness. And I think especially if you look at the sight of an artist, where artist creates his own artwork, where he's able to control what he's doing, you can call it the artist side. There's not an exhibition there or a media coverage and reception. This is not what counts in my understanding. The real manifestation of art occurs a permanent and irremovable place of art created by the artist. this is not always, because I really think when you have this sight of art, the art places in mind and you have a chance to see them, then there is no other institution who is able to, I mean, you can transform it, you can do a lot of things, but if an artist really can control and he's in a good shape, then this is something what we need to understand ourselves. That's what I always was the interest very, very strong. A dedication to new art, this is also has to do with curiosity, what is going on progressive contemporary art. The sight of art created by artists, it is the opposite. The opposite of splendorous and meaningless museums. It is also, I would say, it is an excursion into the unpractical. And what I think the most interesting thing is by working with artists, working together with art institution, or beside that, it is creating spaces that did not exist before. And I think if you make exhibition, if you work with artists, you can do a lot. You can have big names, you can have big artworks, but I think to make on-site a project with an artist is the most interesting, maybe important thing, because it's something which is also for the artist new. It's not that he just is doing what he's able to do, he has to move in another context. And there is a lot to learn as a curator and also for the artist, and I know a lot of artists which have a completely new experience. This doesn't work all the time, and it's always a kind of an experiment. And I don't think art without an experiment works, and an art institution without doing experiments is not anymore an art institution. But this does not work with our society, because we are not kind of, we are not allowed to make too many experiments, and this I spoke with Wolf just before. This is like this mediocrat idea that you, and it's, this has become very strong, but I don't want to go in too much here. I think it's outside is also an imaginary world of the future. And I just want to, I don't know what we meant. When I say a site is always like this, I only want to show some example. One example is they tried the Ringstrasse, like when it was a football championship, the former Stadtrat Schicker tried to bring to make for the football fans and for the football player to bring the city in order, to have something clean and beautiful. So they put in front of the Angewandte and in front of the Mark and all the ring the repeated lamps from the 19th century, from the end of the 19th century, so in Eisenguss iron cast, and they put it also in front of the Mark, and I was very angry. And it really worked in like 2 months with Ross Lovecraft and heavy Italian industry. They never work, but you can negotiate all the time with them. So they made it, this is a rendering, but they made a prototype, and this prototype was here, for a solar tree, for another thing, it was not the idea to have this one-to-one. It worked, it functioned. But it was only just the idea that not everybody has the same. And I mean, I don't want to go on the Ringstrasse and all this thing. This is absolutely also from the intellectual idea is absolutely nonsense, because what the Ringstrasse has is all the styles you could imagine. So this, the lighting, the lamp has only one style. it's also not so much senseless. There is another thing, what I want to say, that it's always, if already you have to run an institution, you have to run outside. You have to go out and inside, and this was also, if you're in like in a community like Vienna, I think you're responsible. You're also responsible to show your own interest. And the own interest, it is not a democratic interest, of course not. It's the interest of very few people, and they have the right, they absolutely have the right to show. And then you can make a discussion. But now we have a discussion, so you can't show anything anymore. Nobody can show anything, because first you have to bring people together and to have all this stupid discussion which nowhere goes. So I don't want to go too much in details. This was only the idea to enlarge the on one hand. It was not the really idea, but it was one of the idea. It was like you always have to have an argument to do something, to enlarge the storage of the library, which is already from the mic. So we put, we tried also in context to the new new Wien Mitte commercial enterprises to put something in for the public, in public. And this is a project with Chris Burden, and we enlarged the bridge, so that under the bridge is hanging the depot, the storage for the, so this would work. And on is it like an axis of these lamps, which Mr. Schicker likes, but coming from California, like 180 lamps, to have an urban structure. Also, they have a link between two districts, which are not so in love, the first and the third. So this is a kind of enlightening. The former Stadtrat didn't like it. It's also, I mean, this is not the case on one hand, if I speak about sight. So I really spend a part of my life here on this side. And I also, to say something to the Angewandte, this is, I could not make my work, to make it just in one sentence, without the institution here, because I think this is some, it's kind of a balance. It's also kind of heaven. I don't call it a university, it doesn't interest me at all, but I'm not so interested in doctor, artist, but what I think there is, what is very important is the research, the theory, and really to go from a completely different point as a museum anytime could do. And this is, I was always, also when there was a conflict or whatever, but I think this is it's very healthy. It's very healthy to have these two institutions in a kind of whatever, dialogue or whatever. So the idea was, and I just be very simple, the idea was also being very long, very long, very, very, very long in an institution to try how to disappear. I mean, I did it now, but in a different way, and, as I was thinking. And this was also what I understand, that all these institutions we have doesn't go anywhere, because everything is done, everything is fixed. Architects, I have to do architecture, those and those and this. So I was more interested in this kind, we called it first UMAC. This was a partnership and a dialogue with the Angewandte and with the director. And then we called it MAC Plus, but this is not the case. The case is to try to really have an institution. And I put some sentences, maybe easier, otherwise I'm confused and then I confuse you. This I don't want to do. The idea was a research center for design, arts, and architecture. A new institution responsible for this course at the interface of art, architecture, design, and society, ranging in the multi-layered field of contemporary position, and production of art. It is a unique research, the idea was to build up a unique research institution that facilitates cross-border projects, addresses crucial issues of our time. And I think this is the most important thing, the crucial issues of our time, to raise the right question. This is all you can do. It's very hard to give answers, and mostly it doesn't make any sense, or not so much sense. But I think especially a school, an art institution, and every exhibition is, from my understanding, to raise a new question in many directions. And this I could believe to have an orientation in a new institution which is, has all these habits we have showing out and develops today a basis of tomorrow. The institution gives to design what it urgently needs, a laboratory for vision with a wide horizon. So the idea was also the institution, you don't need an office building. This was together, it's a little box on a crane or somewhere, and you are linked, and you work in a very international network. And I just show this because we made a Schaulager. This was the idea when we go to, I don't want to go to all this, but only to show this head office, which would be on the top of the crane of this new institution. Also, to have the image that you don't, and I'm very sorry, I always want that architects become also in the future very busy and have commissions, but you have also an institution which you don't need so much architects, but the architects can go in and have are part of the network. This I couldn't understand very much. This was the idea to have this Schaulager there, and I just want to show. This is like, I don't go now too much in details. The idea was that you have an institution which is moving by itself. Also, the aim, the issue is a part where the people find when they work, and you have to make sure that they always, it is renewed. This is kind of the idea. Which I also have not so in didn't have so in mind, when I say the site is for me very important, so just by accident, I had an exhibition already in the MAC. I was creating an exhibition. I just want. I didn't remember that so much. It was 1984. I did an exhibition on the Milanese designer Achille Castiglioni here before I was a part of the game at the museum. So this was also before renovation. It was completely other time, but this was one of my first experiment with an institution, and I don't know. So at this time we put objects in the cage. So this, I couldn't tell you the reason anymore, but it was like it is. And then I was creating a show for Hans Hollein. This was also in the Österreichische Museum für Angewandte Kunst. It was now MAC. This was 66. It was the, we call it the first environment show. So just to show the show, we don't see anything here. This is on the left. It is Professor Hans Hollein. To create a site is not something what you have to put in. You're not can. Only take energy. This is like you have a good image, and then you say everything is fine. You have to always to act. And I just want to show one example. And this is example also for an artist who is dividing maybe artist, because in his strangeness, in his absolute language, he's but. However you see him, He's a great artist, and he did what he thinks he had to do. So it was Donald Judd. He did, as probably some of you know, the is it like they call him a minimalist? He did the Baroque permanent collection. So what I think, what he understand a little bit space, he did this, he didn't want to do it, first of all, because he said he is the one who said also that any museum kills the work of art, and he doesn't want to be too much engaged with the museum, and he doesn't want to do it. But at this time we prepared a show, and we could manage it. And so he did this, and it was like a link. It's a room, this Dubsky, from the Dubsky Palais, and then you have the ceiling. So he matched this in a certain way. Then we had this exhibition, was the first exhibition on it was called Donald Judd Architecture, and I think it's the biggest sculpture he ever did. And then we tried to put it in public space, because I always believe on things like that. And this, I think it took 5 or 6 years to get the permit. They have the most ugly sculpture in the Stadtpark, some of very interesting composers and musicians, but from very bad artists done. And so I understand this is also kind of conflict, and nobody wants to do it. And now it's the problem of the maintenance, and so that is going from one hand to the other. I just want to put something in public space. It means also that you erect it, or your confrontation. So this, if there's a society that's not only going and consuming art, if they really say there's Donald Judd about this fucking sculpture, I don't like it, then you can go, you can even go on the internet, you can have some information. And I think he is one of the guys, one of the few artists who made a huge district for art, for his own art. And I don't make now a lecture on Donald Judd, I just want to give a little spot on that, and where he bought in Marfa, is it, nobody didn't know before, in Texas, a land and a military, I say, baracken, like 34, and a part of the city, which was at this time kind of bankrupt. And I don't want to comment too much, but still, this is like the sculptures he did. It changed in a very little way the existing buildings. Just put glass here, and there, I don't know, there are 65 sculptures. There are six buildings like that who he can show his artwork. And for sure, there is no museums director in the world who could accept it, or that he would be fired before he has the idea. And this is the question, when I speak about art sites, what is the meaning? I will just put it in a question, but for me it was always a very strong interest. I just put this example because he believed that there is no bad architecture, and this was the former central bank, like what is the Erste in Austria, was the Erste in Marfa. But they don't have the head of, is a different one. And he put, like a bank, it has this cliché, which everybody knows, you have the marble and all this stuff, what you need to make secure the place, or to make secure that you put your money in. And he put everything out, only this very naive painting of a local artist he left, and put some furniture in. And so this is like, this is an exposition, and he took a lot of places there. This I just want, once in a while, you're also interested to do something by yourself, and I don't want to go too much. This is a dialogue between a very sensational landscape, which I called it, Wolf mentioned that, I called it the pit, and it was from a 200 years old wine cellar. Was in wine fields, in a quarry, And I think it's a very extraordinary landscape, it's a part of my life. So I did some, this is Stonehenge, has nothing to do so much, but you remember if you do things like that. And I don't want to explain too much. I think it's in a very, very not typically Austrian landscape. It's one of the few landscapes which are not so many breasts and mountains. I just want to, not too much to explain, I just want that this is, for me, something a little bit ingenious and necessary. But then when you have, there's a quarry, and they even made for the cathedral from Santo Stefano, they took until 1920 stones there, this, they're very soft kalk stones. Sasha, you have to be a sculptor to know. So the only thing I want to say is that if the 200 of years to take out stones from the quarry once a while, you have to bring stones back. This was the action I did like more than 20 years ago, and. So there was 36 stones, each of them has like 3 tons, that was an action. Then one of the few buildings is toilet. I think it's the first thing, if you a landscape, you need a toilet, and that's also I did. The toilet is, because I'm social open, so it is a two-seater, which is normal, and I invited sometimes my friends. Then I did the 37 stone, so this was trying to make a building or make a house. I think it in a certain way it worked. It was like the people still hate it because they said this is a Bewak Trafo Station because it doesn't have a window in the front of the sea. This is the inside, but outside. So, okay. Then Carlos Capa, which nobody of you know, the students now, because you're just now and in these days. So he was a very interesting, or he's still a very interesting Venetian architect. And if you once have the chance, you go to Azuero and visit the Tomba Brion. So he was there, and he was not finished at this time, but he was delighted. I want to show on one exhibition what it means to make, what it really means to make a show, and this was when I say site specific. This was something was I couldn't imagine you could it even make more site specific. Vito Acconci, when the show was finished, he was sitting at the Stadtpark and he really had tears in his eye because he said he never did a work like that. I mean, it was time ago. And because he took all his energy and I took all the money the Republic of this country had. So, what he did was very simple. He did nothing else. An architect, I remember, they hated it very much. He did nothing else as to repeat that was the existent, that what was there. He repeated the space. He repeated the central exhibition hall of the MAC, one-to-one. And even architects know, if you repeat it one-to-one, it doesn't figure in. So he had to shift it. And this he did, but he did it with more solid materials, as it was done, because he wanted to have the sensation that you can walk on the roof of the museum, which you can't. If I would be the director, I would not allow you to walk on the sky space, on the roof. So he made the roof in more solid glass as the existing roof. So I show you, I just because we are in a world of name droppings, you say I've Vito Acconci, I have Art Schwager, I think this doesn't make any, it's absolutely senseless if you're not trying to go in a relation with an artist. And I think this was, for both of us, a strong relation. It could also because it could cut my head. And this time, I don't know, they didn't do it. So this was the space. He put inside the, it was really built in solid material. It was no paper, not like the Guggenheim in Bilbao. We had there the from Kapoor, the cannon. There was immediately a hole when they were shooting it to the corner because it was cardboard and not so much. So it's not, I mean, it's my, I appreciate the Bilbao project very much, but I speak from materials. So I can just...
42 Tonnen Stahl für die Konstruktion. 2 Monate Arbeitszeit. Die bestehende Glasdecke ist das Zentrum der Installation. Sie wird im versinkenden und aufsteigenden Zustand nachgebaut. Sie teilt den Zentralraum horizontal in 2 schräge Hälften. Ihre tragenden Stahlbetonstützen ragen auf einem Streifen von 2 Metern über den Zentralraum hinaus in die angrenzende U-förmige Ausstellungshalle. Alles soll für das Publikum begehbar sein. Sandwiched zwischen dem Gipfel des sinkenden Raumes und dem bestehenden Raum.
After 2 years restoration, renovation of the Seidenhalle, and also I could not, they were very carefully the restorators restored the paintings because it was still from the war. So I was always a little bit scary that it is becomes a new building, it becomes too glittery, too kind of this ugly beautiness. Okay, they did it, and then I think it's very important that you once a while make a clear statement of now, of contemporary, and I was very often very lucky. I invited a great artist, Magdalena Yetilova, and immediately after the restorators left the building, she moved in. And I think it's, this is not a permanent, but I think it's very, it is permanent for the memory, and it works, and I think it's very good also for this institution, for the next decades and directors, that there happened something from a, what I think a very, very important artist. Another case which has to do to really to go, I mean, you can do it on and on. The problem is that the Republic becomes running out of money, especially for art, and it's very hard to afford such such projects. I believe, and I want to say this on this point, that the orientation, if you have an art institution, can't be the public. No, I should not say it too loud, but I always say it as much as I can, because this is not an orientation. You have to, the only one is the artist. You have to serve the artist, you have to find a relation with the artist, and then you have to, maybe you can sell it to the public, but you can't, you're not allowed to do that, that you ask the public what they want to see, because what do they see? They want to see what they know. Therefore, you have all these programs all over the world, which are completely senseless, have nothing to do with art. So this was also eine Sternstunde. Anish Kapoor, he made an art piece, the Kanone, was called Shooting in the Corner. He made this for this exhibition. It's now in the Flak Tower, and he donated this piece, which has a value, because everybody speaks about values, and like 20 million euro. He's one of these artists who is very strong in the art market too, not only as an artist. Let's see. Just give an idea. So it's a machine created by the artist who makes the artwork for the artist. Yeah, it's all about. Everything is explained in a very short video. It was to create next to the Schindler House, one of the Schindler House, the Mack is running, to create a space like a garage top, which is not so easy next to Schindler. And
this is not a curated show.
And we made it with a show, the opening.
A real operation, a multiple small cells.
This was the garage project, which in LA is
chaos. And chaos is the basic of art, no? First of all, the garage has a little tradition with this city, but it's also the smallest item of the space. They're very strong artists. I think there are those out there really remarkable artists, all of them, and they have a big respect to each one, and this is the only way that it can work.
I think it's an open field. It's art, or it's architecture, it's design, yeah. And we are all in the same boat, yeah? And to have a discussion in a interesting atmosphere. LA is interesting meet point. I think we need this all, yeah?
This is part of what I think is in our dimension, to keep deconstructing and reshaping what the museum is. So the MAC is not any longer an institution that is related to one building, like the one in Vienna, the traditional museum, but it becomes much more like a guerrilla operation, a multiple small cells.
Trying to give you a slight idea what I'm doing now. This is a project which is not Thomas Krenz, the former Guggenheim director, invited me, and I will have a negotiation. This is the Empire, the forbidden city in Beijing, Taimiyan. I won't stay so much. I am making two shows at the Biennale in Venice, for this art Biennale. One is with Kern van Mechelen. He's an exceptional artist, and it is a small video, so I don't want to speak too much on him. And I think the idea is, this is the main library in Venice, a very traditional library, and we tried to make an intervention. It's rented for 6 months for the time of the Biennale, and we tried to make, it's called NATO a Venezia, open university, so it is an interactive place, and it's in the Palazzo Loredan, so this is the center of intellectual kind of in Venice. And this is the building, which you probably know. This is the title of the exhibit. And here you have all from Michelangelo, all the very young, young nation, Italy, just this year, 150 years. So you have all these celebrities there, and he is make a cross-breeding chicken, and one chicken will be born during the Biennale in Venezia. So this is the project is this very small irritation. If you don't, most of the people can't look anymore. Most of us don't see anything anymore, so probably nobody sees what's going on. But I can try. I can try. So you have the chicken, which is. But we let. You have like Andrea Palladio is there, Dante Alighieri. So all these figures who were so important for this young nation, Italy, are together with a newborn animal. This is very beautiful library. This is the space, and there will be the interactive working station. They are connected to three universities, and they make by diversity, they make a program during the Biennale. There's the crossbreeding will be in Murano, and there's a live stream. The live stream is going to the library.
Steve, what brings you to the chicken? chickens are the most domesticated animals in the world. And that's really very interesting, because there is only one chicken in the world. It is the regular fowl that lives in the Himalaya. And by human interest, they make in every country a chicken that tells something about the country. For me, it's now interesting to see what we did with this chicken. We blocked the chicken. We make a standard of it, and we are thinking that we have to keep the standard forever. And that is what I say now against domestication. We have to break the frame that we make around the chicken, so we have to set it free. And that's why I start my cosmopolitan chicken crossbreeding program. So I select in every country a chicken, and I start to crossbreed them. By doing this, you tell everything about our society.
But do you have any right to put a chicken in a museum?
Do we have the right to make a museum? I mean, that's also a space. That's a domesticated place. Yeah. So what I do is question the whole thing. And by putting the chicken into a museum, you already set a question. Has the museum the right to exist? How do we shape the boundaries of the museum? Is the museum not a place that we should break open and to go to the world?
How you touch art? What is your intention? Why you don't keep science naked? Why you keep science as science? Why you want to have this kind of jumping into the art?
Because I don't think that art can exist without the imagination. And art brings imagination. I think science on its own cannot go forward. I don't believe it. I believe that that if you make this kind of combination and you give some kind of spirit from both sides, that something new can be born. I always believe in the junction of something. That's why my project is a crossbreeding project. And not only the chicken has to crossbreed, but also the idea and the knowledge has to crossbreed.
What's the difference between a scientist who would have this idea for crossbreeding in a different context, and what do you do?
I think it's a very big difference. First of all, a scientist will never start with this kind of project. He has to keep himself on a protocol, so he has to follow that. He cannot do this. And the second reason, he has only an interest in the outcome. And he's trying to predict the outcome. That means that he has a very clear image of what it will be. Me as an artist, I have no clear image of what it will be. The image is the surprise. That is one thing. And the second thing, I keep it open, because I believe not in manipulating the things. I believe in mutation. That's a really big difference. Then you can become the watcher of the things that you are doing.
It's called Nato a Venezia, so this is a kind of a beginning, it's a start. So where does it go, where does it end, when we take the show at the Art Biennale in Venice, Nato a Venezia? So
I think Nato a Venezia is very important, because for the first time, we go really beyond the chicken. So we will start the discussion as the Open University of Diversity. We will really show the world that it is beyond the chicken a lot of ideas, that we have an open study where everybody who has the interest can take part of it. And from there on, it goes to different places in the world.
Ich glaube, nur einen Satz dazu. Das ist natürlich das, was mein Interesse auch ist, ist sozusagen die, my interest is like how science meet art, and he's in many directions an exceptional artist, and this we will see. So this will take place, as I mentioned. There's another exhibition, it's a big struggle, a struggle always in Venice, as you know, and also with the people are involved, and everything is under in process, under construction. Many things are not finalized. This is the other palazzo, this is the Palazzo Cavalli Facchetti, this is next to the Academia Bridge. So it's outside of the Biennale campus. So even people which are not interested in art have the chance to see that. I'm doing a site-specific work with certain artists, and this is a good link. These are the artists which are part of the show. And to say site-specific, that means, of course, that there's an intervention for Venice, for the city of Venice, for the place itself, for the palazzo. And I think it's far away, but it's still not done now, because there are many problems, and always problems of permits, of permissions from the officials, but not only from the officials. This is like, one is Kendall Gears, he's on the left. Kendall Gears is one of the artists. This is an artist I appreciate very much. He's doing from this kind of, I don't want to say this, like LA police has this kind of, they're doing this in glass, because the organization who is taking care of the exhibition is a glass industry, so they like to do that. And this is the project. This is quite huge. It's like about more than 2.5 meters. It's only not a very good image here. He is using glass and is making two sculptures. Then there's one of Zaha Hadid. I mean, what she's doing is an object on, like, you can use it. I think it's very complicated. It's, now they're working on a maquette, on a model, because the surface is in a not easy way to make. And all this glass, which is done now, all these factories, they make only kitsch production, is the worst, you know, in Venice. So they're not anymore able to do that, what they have done 200 years ago. So I think this is also makes a lot of sense to provocate with an object like that. If one of you don't remember Zaha, so I just want to show you. Just one second more. So this is the object. Then there's an interesting project with Erwin Wurm. This is the guy who is this industrial, the glass guy, who is taking care of the exhibition space of the palazzo. Wurm is also doing some objects together. And the really, let's see what we have. Then we have, there's one video, which maybe you know, he did it last year. This is, the title is Taylor, a young couple driving in their car through Vienna and speaking about reality. That's all you can do in Vienna. This is one of the objects. This is the artist himself, if you remember. And this is a gift, an Austrian gift for Venice. This is the sculpture of Erwin Wurm, and this is will be there. And I think this is a good first result. It's a good dialogue between a palazzo, which has no meaning anymore, because you rent it out. Everybody can rent a palazzo. There's not one palazzo who is, there's a family who has power and is running that, so this is an empty case. So the question is, it's very interesting. Also, Venice is a site of Vienna, and this is also the house. This is this house where Erwin Wurm, he did grow up there. But it's squashed. No, it's squashed on 1.60 meters. And I think the art society, they will like it. The other case is the project with Magdalena Jentilova. this was just recently to trying to make an advertisement for the exhibition is called Glass Stress. So we put ourselves under stress to put the wine glass on top of us. The other thing is for sure not serious, all these parties. But this was not, so there was no understanding whatever. No, it was no. Then she went further because she understood also if Wurm is there with his house, the palazzo doesn't make any sense anymore. So she wanted to put it to Vienna. I don't know when she was the last time here, but this was this project, so I don't have to be nervous. It won't happen. It was so she tried very long, and it was like for many weeks and months. We went to the commissions and everything. I don't know. There is something wrong in Venice, or something doesn't work. So there were variations of that. And finally, which is now she's working on that now, is she puts a mirror in this space, and so she will shift, and the mirror is in the move. So the environment, the space will become another direction. Other dimension. This is very hard to understand, and I want to finish with this sentence, with this statement from this will be on the mirror. And this is like a physical, which I didn't know. Everything moves, but not the writing moves. So maybe this has also something to say. And the guiding principle of my understanding is that the greatest risk is risk avoidance. So I want to thank you for being here.